Okay, assalamualaikum and also good morning.
Okay, anyhow, kita kena habiskan. Okay, ini adalah kuliah yang terakhir. Our last lecture. Okay, today we will talk about two more control design. Okay, one is pre-filter and the other one is the deadbeat response. Okay, I will explain a system with a pre-filter and also design for deadbeat response. Okay, you can refer to the books section 10.10 and also 10.11. Although we have many methods already that we have learned, okay, but these are the two more that we need to learn. Okay, when we talk about the pre-filter, okay, last time we said that there are four types of compensator. The one that we discussed a lot before is cascade compensator, where the compensator is between the comparator and also the process. Okay, but now when we talk about the pre-filter is the compensator is before the comparator. Okay, after the input, let's look the effect of the compensator. Okay, most of the compensator that we do, okay, for example, the phase lead, the phase lag, and also the integration, the PI, okay, and also even when we talk about the PID, okay, most of them are the compensator that we add here, okay. And when we talk about the pre-filter is basically a compensator that we add here, okay. But normally the pre-filter is utilized to improve the response of this compensator, okay. We add additional pre-filter in front, okay. As we know that the compensator alters the root of the closed loop system, okay. When we add the compensator, it will alter the root of the compensator of the closed loop system, since they add either the zero or the poles. So normally in the compensator as a cascade here, we add either zero or poles. So the closed loop transfer function will contain zero of compensator, for example like this. And when we add the zero, normally there are effect to the system. As we learn in chapter 5, when we have the zero, we add the zero to the second order system, okay, the location of the zero will affect the system response. Let's consider a system with an open loop transfer function like this. Let's say the system is the process is very simple. GS is equal to 1 over S. And when we introduce the PI compensator, okay, here, basically we adding a 0 because our GC will be the proportional plus the integrals, okay? Or in other words, we can write it in this form. GC, which is equal to KP multiplied by S plus KI divided by S. Okay, as we know, when we add this PI, basically we are adding one pole located at origin, and then the other we add a zero located at KI divided by KP. And basically when we add this zero will give an effect to the system response. Since normally when we design the system, basically we just consider the characteristic equation, which is the pole. So with that, for the system without the pre-filter, okay, the transfer function for the system, basically we have the closed loop. So the closed loop basically GC multiply by G divided by 1 plus GC multiply by G. The only thing, the H is equal to 1. Okay. So we just put the H equal to 1. The only thing, because we have the pre-filter in front, okay, after we simplify the closed loop, we got the equation transfer function for the closed loop, we need to multiply with the pre-filter. So if we add the equation for GC and also the G is just now is equal to 1 over S, okay, and the GC is equal to KP multiplied by S plus K1 divided by S, okay, and if we put the value of GC and also G and we try to simplify it, we will get the equation like this. KP multiplied by S plus K1 divided by S square plus KPS multiplied by K1. Okay? This one after we simplify, after we adding the GC and also G in this equation. Okay? The only thing, we just leave the GP equal to GP. Okay? When we talk a system without a pre-filter, okay, basically we just make the GP equal to 1. Okay, so we have only this transfer function. Okay, let's say if we are given a specification that the percent of overshoot is 4%. If the percent of overshoot is 4%, okay, from that equation we can find what is the value of zeta, the damping ratio. Do you remember the equation for the damping ratio for the second order system? PO equal to 100 multiplied by exponential of minus zeta pi divided by square root of 1 minus zeta square. Okay? And if you equate that equal to 4, okay? And you find the value for the damping ratio, you get the zeta equal to 0.707. Okay? And then the second specification is given is the settling time, which is 0.5 second. Okay, this is based on 2% criterion. You know, for the settling time, the 2% criterion, the equation is equal to 4 divided by zeta omega n, and this should be equal to 0.5. Okay, from here we can find the value of zeta multiplied by omega n, which is equal to 4 divided by 0.5, which is equal to 8. Okay, once we know this, because we know the zeta from the first specification before, so we can calculate the omega n. Now basically it's equal to 8 divided by 0.707, which is roughly equal to 11.31. So this is the transfer function with the pre-filter. Okay, for the transfer function without the pre-filter, basically if we know that the GP is equal to 1, okay, and then we need, so the equation will become KP multiplied by S plus K1, okay, and then this whole thing multiplied by 1 divided by S square plus KP multiplied by S plus K1, okay. And from this characteristic equation, because we know that this is a second order equation, okay, so we can put that at the border of the specification, okay, where since this one is equal to 2 multiplied by zeta omega n, right, okay. So that's why KP is equal to 2 multiplied by zeta multiplied by omega n. Sin zeta multiplied by omega n, we know the value is 8 here. So we just substitute there. So the Kp should be 16. Okay. And then for Ki, Ki basically, because it's located here, this is equivalent to omega n square. Okay. Because we have the value of omega n, which is this one, 11.31. Okay. We can, we just square them. So what we get, basically 128. Okay. So basically now your second order equation now is become s to the power of 2 plus 16s plus 128. Okay. And the top also need to follow. Okay. 16 multiplied by s multiplied plus 128. So whenever the, if the GP is equal to 1 basically, now your transfer function will become like this. Okay. S to the power, the characteristic equation is s to the power of 2 plus 16s plus 128. Okay, this one is 16s plus 128. So if you just factor the 16, you get s plus 8. So now, if you look at your transfer function, okay, for a system without the pre-filter, where the GP is equal to 1, you have a second order characteristic equation here, okay, and from this one you will get two poles, two complex poles. Okay, if you find the root for this complex pole, basically the complex pole will be located at negative 8 plus and minus 8j. And now on the top here you have a zero, and the zero is located at negative 8. So now you notice the position, the zero located at negative 8, the real part of the complex pole is located at negative 8 as well. So which one actually dominant? So in this case the zero is location is same as the real part of the complex pole, that the supposed the dominant poles. Okay, so that's why the zero will be affecting. Okay, that's why if we look at the after you get that transfer function, you can use the Scilab to get the response, and then you can measure the percentage of overshoot. Or beside that, you can refer back to the graph in chapter 5, okay, where you have the ratio of the zero and also the complex, the real part of the complex pole. Okay, in this case where we have the real the zero is located at negative 8, and the real part of the complex pole is also at negative 8. So basically the ratio is equal to 1. Okay, the ratio is equal to 1. And then we know that the damping ratio that we have is equal to 0.707. So somewhere near to following this curve. This is 0.7. So it's almost near there. So the point is here. So this is the percentage of overshoot somewhere here. Okay, from this graph we got the percentage of overshoot. Okay, so if we try to determine the percentage of overshoot from this graph, we will find that the percentage of overshoot will be around 21%. Okay. If you use Scilab, you can do the same thing. Just put the transfer function that we got before, and if we plot the response and measure the PO, I think we will get the PO around 21% as well. Okay. So basically, the zero here has affected the response. Why we can say that? Why we saying that like that? Because initially we trying to have a system with a 4% overshoot only, right? Okay. But now when your system having a zero, actually by the characteristic equation that we have, okay, based on the damping ratio and also the natural frequency, okay, we have calculated that the percentage of overshoot should be around 4%. Okay, but when we measure the PO, we find the PO is already 21%. So that means the zero that exists there has affected the response. Okay, has increased the percentage of overshoot. Okay, that's why in this case we need a system with a pre-filter. A pre-filter will eliminate zero from transfer function while maintaining the gain of one. Okay, the purpose of the pre-filter is to eliminate the zero, because if we can eliminate the zero, we will eliminate the effect of the zero to the response. Okay, so in that case, in the case that we did just now, the examples, we need a pre-filter like this, because we have the zero S plus 8, right? On the top right. So in order to cancel out there, we need to multiply with 1 over S plus 8. So that zero with the zero in the transfer function will cancel out each other. Okay? The only thing, in order for us to maintain the gain so that it will not reduce, okay, since here is 8, on top here we need to put 8 as well. That just to maintain the gain so that the gain will equal to 1. Okay? So as a result, our transfer function before, where initially without the pre-filter, the GP is equal to 1, but now our GP is equal to 8 divided by S plus 8. So actually this S plus 8 and this S plus 8 will cancel out together. Okay? And then what will happen? We will have a transfer function like this. Okay? You can see the results. Our transfer function is only have a second order characteristic equation. There is no additional zero anymore. Okay, because we have eliminated the zero. Okay, so by eliminating the zero, the percentage of overshoot can be kept low. Okay, so that the response will just follow the location of the poles. Okay? So in this case, if we have a system like this, basically we know that the omega n square is equal to 128. Basically the omega n is basically equal to square root of 128. Okay? And then the 2 zeta omega n from here is equal to 16. And then we will get the zeta will be equal to 8 divided by square root of 128, which is equal to 0.707. Okay, and then if we calculate the percentage of overshoot based on that, we will get the percentage of overshoot will be 4.5%. So thus the pre-filter will keep the percentage of overshoot low, okay, by eliminating the zero, okay, from affecting the response. System with a lead or PI compensator should utilize a pre-filter to avoid the effect of zero in the compensator. You remember when we add the phase lead compensator, we add a zero and also poles, okay, and then with the gain K, right? Okay, so because we adding the zero, that's why we need to add the pre-filter so that the effect of the zero won't change the response. Okay, similarly also with the PI a compensator, as we have seen in the example just now. Okay, because by doing this we add a zero in PI, we add a zero and also a pole at origin. Okay, so since we adding the zero, okay, we need to add a pre-filter so that we can cancel out that zero from affecting the response. Okay, however, system with the lag compensator, the phase lag compensator, do not need a pre-filter. Okay, since the effect of zero is insignificant. Because why? Because last time when we designed the phase lag, we have located the zero and also the pole very close together, right? And that pole and zero, they have cancelled out each other because of the closeness, the location. That's why the zero are not affecting the response in the phase lag compensator. Thus, in phase lag compensator, we don't need to add a pre-filter. Okay, the last design method that I will teach you is a deadbeat response. Deadbeat response is a response that proceed rapidly to the desired level and hold at that level with minimal overshoot. The acceptable range of variation from the desired response is the plus and minus 2% band at settling time. So when we talk about deadbeat response, this is the appearance of the deadbeat response. Okay, you see the response. Okay, it's respond very very fast, but when you reach here, okay, you get a little overshoot. The overshoot should be less than 2%, and then after that just fluctuating within the band of 2%, plus and minus 2%. Okay, so that is the deadbeat response. So if your system can achieve this response, this is the best response. Just now also, before also, when we try to design our system by adding the compensator and so on, basically we wanted to make our response having the response some sort like this, if possible. Okay, and the characteristic of deadbeat response is that no steady state error. So basically the steady state settle at value 1, so the final value is same as the desired response. Okay, and then the fast response, minimum rest time and settling time. If we note here, the settling time is basically is here. Okay, and if we find the rest time, maybe we can measure the 10% until 90%. That's basically the rest time. And then the percentage of overshoot, normally between 0.1% to 2%. Okay, not more than 2%. Okay, and then finally, if there is undershoot also, the undershoot also should be less than 2% as well. To get the optimal deadbeat response, actually we need to we can determine the transfer function for it. The only thing is that later on, if we wish to have the our system to have a deadbeat response, we need to make the system to have that transfer function. If your process doesn't meet that transfer function, you need to add the compensator in order to make the transfer function equal to the transfer function of dead bed response. So this is macam apa, kita work backward lah. Okay, macam yang tadi kebanyakan design kita work daripada specification and then kita daripada the process dan sebagainya, and then kita dapat transfer function and then kita nilai dia punya respon macam mana. Okay, di sini kita nakkan respon tersebut and then kita work backward on the transfer function. So to determine the coefficient that yield the optimal dead bed response, the standard transfer function is first normalized. Okay, for example, a third order system transfer function, cuma there are standard transfer function. Okay, yang selalu kita lihat adalah yang untuk second order. Second order kita ada S square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Okay, cuma 2 multiply by omega tu, 2 multiply by zeta kita consider as alpha. Okay, in the second order system. Okay, but for and then the for second order system, di atas ini adalah omega n square. Okay, but for the third order system, basically kita ada s to the power of 3 plus alpha multiply by omega n, okay, multiply by s to the power of 2, and then plus beta multiply by omega n square multiply by s, and then plus omega n to the power of 3. Okay, and di atas ni is always sama dengan hujung ini, which is omega n to the power of 3. Okay, so this is third order system, the transfer function earned for a third order system. Okay, in order for us to get the normalized transfer function, okay, we need to divide the numerator and denumerator by omega n to the power of 3. Sebab kita nak jadikan yang belakang ni jadi 1. Okay, jadi what we need to do, we need to divide by omega n to the power of 3. Jadi kalau kita buat yang tu, atas ni kita divide by omega n to the power of 3, yang ini kita divide kepada omega n to the power of 3, akan jadi 1. Yang ini kita akan divide by omega n to the power of 3, jadi kita akan dapat beta multiply by s divided by omega n. Okay, and then this one also we need to divide with omega n to the power of 3. Okay, jadi kita akan dapat alpha multiply by s square divided by omega n square. And then yang ini juga kita perlu divide by omega n to the power of 3. Cuma sekarang ni bila you tengok this equation, the characteristic equation, nampak tak? Bila kita normalize, this one will become 1, the last one. Dan yang ini kita akan ada s to the power of 1 divided by omega n to the power of 1. Yang ini akan jadi s to the power of 2 divided by omega n to the power of 2. Okay, yang ini jadi s to the power of 3 divided by omega n to the power of 3. So the normalized transfer function, basically apa kita boleh buat, yang ini s to the power s divided by omega n, kita boleh replace dengan s bar. Okay, jadi kalau kita replace dengan s bar, kita ada normalized transfer function kita sebagai ini, 1 divided by s bar to the power of 3 alpha plus s bar to the power of 2 plus beta multiply by s bar plus 1. Dan bila kita kata this is normalized transfer function, okay, year sesuai for any system. Okay, in this case for third order system, tak kira lah, kan? Whatever you punya value, ini sebenarnya general. You boleh gunakan to any system yang mana untuk third order. Okay, you will have the equation for the second order. You will have the equation for the fourth order and so on. Okay. And if you notice that in this normalized transfer function, you have the parameter called alpha and beta here. Okay, alpha and beta is basically called as the coefficient. Okay, of course, if you have a second order, you have only alpha only. Okay, if you have third order, you have alpha and beta, and then if you have fourth order, you have four parameter, alpha, beta, and the other one. Okay, so this is the table of the coefficient for different order. Okay, for the second order, basically the alpha is equal to 1.882. Okay, for the third order, the alpha is equal to 1.90 here. Okay, and then the beta is equal to 2.2. Okay, and then the fourth order, the alpha is equal to 2.2, and beta is equal to 3.5, and gamma is equal to 2.80. Okay, and so on lah. Okay, so basically it depends. For your system, okay, just determine what order is your system is. Okay, if you know the order, you just select the value of the coefficient from this table. Okay, let's say in our case, if we select the third order, our system is third order, so we select this, the row of the third order. Okay, so for a third order system, if we look at these tables, basically the alpha is equal to 1.9 and beta is equal to 2.20, and then the other important data is this one. Okay, this one is the data of the performance measure. Okay, if you look here, this is the percentage of overshoot. Okay, if you have third order, a second order, the percentage of overshoot will be around 0.1%. Okay, if you have third order, the percentage of overshoot will be 1.65. If you have fourth order, the percentage of overshoot will be 0.89. So if you look here, all of them, basically the percentage of overshoot will be less than 2%. Okay, and this is the percentage of undershoot. The percentage of undershoot also, if you notice from here, basically less than 2% as well. Okay, and this is omega n multiplied by TR1. This is normalized race time 1. Okay, in second basically. Okay, so for the third, our third order, it is equal to 3.48. okay, so you can check basically the race time. Okay, it is not very long. It is, the biggest here is around 5 seconds. Okay, this is the race time. Okay, the race time, the biggest is, I think, around 6.58 seconds. And this one is the normalized settling time. So this is the normalized settling time. So in our case, let's see, our normalized settling time is 4.40. Let's say if our specification is given in the form of settling time. Let's say we wanted the settling time is around 1.2 seconds. If it is 1.2 seconds, the only thing we note here that our normalized settling time for the third order will be 4.04 seconds. Okay, so in that case, because we know the settling time already here, okay, so we if we plug in the settling time here, basically we can calculate the omega n. So omega n will be equal to 4.04 divided by 1.2, which is equal to 3.37. This is the our normalized our natural frequency, okay, omega n. And once we know this value omega n, okay, it depends, sometimes the settling time is given, but sometimes is the rest time also given, you can utilize this value to find the omega n, okay, or the rest time 1, for example, is given, and then you from this point, from this value, basically you can calculate for the omega n. Okay, once in this equation we know the value of alpha, beta and also omega n, okay, basically you can plug into this equation. Okay, you know alpha, beta and also omega n, so you just plug into that equation. Okay, so when you plug in that value in those in that equation for the value of alpha, beta and also the omega n, okay, and then you can get your final transfer function. Okay, so this is your final transfer function for your system. Okay, once you get this transfer function, okay, you need to make your transfer function of your system to be equal to this transfer function. So how you can do that? Normally we have the transfer function for the process, right? Okay, so if you compare your transfer function of the process with this transfer function, anything that deficient you can put at the compensator, right? So that it can cancel out and so on until you get the transfer function like this, right? Okay, so whatever you add in the either in the GC, okay, transfer function to compensate for this, for the process that does not have transfer function exactly like this, okay, and you can also add the pre-filter as well. Okay, so I think if you put the GP and also GEC, okay, to fit to and with your G of the process, okay, to fit this equation, okay, basically whatever you put for your compensator, okay, will help you getting the response like this. So out of so many design method, basically this one is the easiest actually. So hopefully if there is question also come out about this is design method, I hope you can do it. Okay, this is the easiest actually. We need to find the normalized transfer function because this coefficient is given for a normalized system so that it can fit to all case. Okay, for general case. Okay, because each case has different value of natural frequency, right? If you change the natural frequency, basically the value of the coefficient will be different. Okay, But since this one is already normalized, okay, so this is coefficient will be fit to any case. Okay. The only thing through this performance measure, basically through the specification, you can calculate what is your omega n and you can revert back to your system with a specific natural frequency. Okay, as a summary, students have learned compensator at zero to the closed loop transfer function. The effect of zero on the step response is significant by increasing the percentage of overshoot. A pre-filter eliminates zero from transfer function and thus keeps the percentage of overshoot low. Okay, dead beat response is a response that proceeds rapidly to the desired level and hold at the level with minimal overshoot. Okay, so the coefficient and the response measure of the standard transfer function are available for optimal dead beat response. So what you have learned will become foundation for designing feedback control system. Okay, just remember, tomorrow we have a tutorials for chapter 10. Okay, on Thursday we don't have class. Okay, and on Friday we have a test, the second test. Okay, please make sure you come to the test because that is the last session that we have. And if anyone could not attend, I will have difficulty to make up another test. Okay, because that is the last date of the semester.